So is this time
So last time when we did the Git session, right? So we are facing some issue in the HTTP mode, right? HTTPS. So I got the solution. So Ravindra, did you got the solution or?
I think I got the solution actually. I have even I was able to do it using the same
okay.
command restore. So I don't think so there was any challenge. I think I got the solution that time. Okay, you are asking about the HTTPS. HTTPS,
yes,
right?
Yes, yes. So
yeah.
The fix is like you need to go to your credential manager if you are using
mm-hmm.
Windows, and
yeah.
there you need to modify your GitLab settings. When you go to this, you go to edit, and what GitLab is doing, the login credential which you are using to login into GitLab, that same username and password needs to be provided here. Then only it will be communicated through HTTPS.
Okay, thank you. I understand. Yeah,
so you just change it and have a try. If still you are facing some issue, then we need to identify what is the another root cause or something. Okay. So for today's session,
sure.
So for today's session, we are touching upon GitLab a bit more detail. So whatever required from a DevOps professional point of view. So few things we have already covered in the Git session, like how to create the account and how to add SSH key. So this is the consolidated agenda of GitLab, what we are we'll cover today. GitLab, what is the use of GitLab, Git commands, how to add SSH key, create project, create branch, add a file. These three are more important, rebase, squashing and merging. So as you know, GitLab is a service that provides to access your Git repositories remotely, and you can host your code with their GitLab. So it also provides some additional features like managing and sharing your code between different people among your team members for the review process. If whatever the changes you did, it's fine, it looks good. Any bug tracking, defects you can directly attach to your code, wiki space and other tools for social coding designed to help manage the software development lifecycle. So whatever facilities we are achieving through Git, through command line or GUI, so most of the facilities we can also access through GitLab from the GitLab GUI. And more beyond that as well. So this can be used for internal management of Git repositories. Like if you are trying to do a private repository of yourself or public repository, so that can be easily manageable with GitLab. It's a self-hosted Git repository management system that keeps the user code private and can easily deploy the changes of the code. So the main purpose of GitLab, what we are saying, so nowadays GitLab is being used wide in almost every organization, although there are different options of managing Git repositories, like I mentioned here, GitHub and Bitbucket. So for private repositories, GitHub has done the paid version after takeover by Microsoft. But GitLab and Bitbucket, I guess, GitLab is completely free. You can use your private and public. Bitbucket is also similar to GitLab. So why to use GitLab? It's like you can, as you mentioned, you can host your private projects, also public projects. It's a platform where you can review your code among your team members, and it is easily shareable, and also only the snippet of the code can be shareable. Like if you go into the diff category, so you can see what are the only difference between previous commit and new commit, so that it will be easy to analyze. Obviously, the person who will approve or will review, he or she must have the knowledge of the code base which he or she is going to review it. Then only it will be benefit for check the difference part. Okay, otherwise it will be like some lemon if see the dip. So it could be like only 2-3 word change, so he or she has a perfect perception like this is the only change. But when you get the complete understanding of the code base, then only it will be easy to analyze and review. GitLab provides also its own CI system for managing the projects and provides user interface along with other features of GitLab. So we'll see more how GitLab helps in continuous integration part in the subsequent sessions, like when we are doing integration of GitLab with Jenkins. So there we will cover this one, continuous integration part. Advantages, like it is a community edition, GitLab provides community edition version for users to locate on which servers their code is present. So it is open source also, so you will get a lot of help from the community members. If you stuck somewhere, if you want suggestion, if you need guidance, so you can easily put your comments in the community, in the GitLab community, so you'll get the responses. What are the disadvantages? It is the only disadvantage we can figure out is it's bit latency as compared to GitHub. A bit slower than GitHub, but it is not that much slower. That is the only disadvantage I have seen till now. So these are a set of Git commands which can be used corresponding in parallel with GitLab. So we have covered most of the commands in our Git session. So it is just a replica of those commands. When you get with time, you can check. Well, this is a small snippet of commands actually. There are a lot of Git commands which is applicable in Git that is the same as for GitLab. So the two commands I want to highlight here below, that if you want to merge any branch to the master, so you need to first check out to the branch and then use the git merge master command. And if you want to merge master to your branch, so first you need to check out to the master and then you have go to your and merge run the merge command in with your branch name. So I hope I'm audible clearly, right, Anil?
Yes, we are all clear.
Okay. So SSH key, we have already discussed this in the last, how to generate your key and how to add those key in your repository. I'm not going to repeat this again. So I hope there is no doubt in this SSH key addition. We have already done the hands-on also, right? So guys, I'm not looking into the chat, so you can use your voice mic to respond actually. Okay, it will be helpful for me. So create project also we had covered. You can log into your account and do the create project. We did a hands-on on this as well when we discussed the Git in the Git session. This is the same as those list of commands. In fact, we are planning to cover this in that session as well, but since that session got a bit extended, so we left this part. So now comes create a branch. So till now, we covered how we are doing it in the master branch. Okay, that is the main branch. So how to create your branch using GitLab? So there is option when you go to your repository. So here we have an option like in the left hand panel that create a branch. So you'll get option that new branch, and you give the name of that branch, and then create it. So after creating, you will get this kind of screen that it is been created. So this is the alternate of the command which we are using in command line, git checkout hyphen b and branch name, or git branch and branch name. So that will create from the command line, and this by this process you can create directly in the GitLab, that is in your remote repository, using your GUI interface. So I can show you how to do that. So I think we last created this project, so we have this file. So you go to repository and you will see the branches. So here you can create a new branch, and you can give a good name according to your. So generally the trend followed by organization, you should give the ticket ID, like Jira ID or whatever the tool you are using for a ticket tracking purpose. So that ID should be here, so that it will be, if it is integrated with your defect management tool, so that will be directly visible there. Like when you create the branch, or when you create the pull request, so it will directly visible in your Jira dashboard inside the store. So the point is, either you name it in your like defect ID or story ID, epic ID, whatever you want. So that is a good practice. Or else some organization follow like this trend, features, class, and the branch name, whatever you want. So this can also be done. So for this session, for this hands-on purpose, we can simply give some other command like branching, test branching we can give. So you can choose from which branch you can create. So I will create from master. So from which branch means, this will helpful when you have branching strategy in your organization or in your personal project as well. Like I mentioned in the earlier session, most of the organization which adopts DevOps nowadays. So they are following the trend like this will be your master branch, and here we have a development branch, and here we have a QA branch. So if you are doing some feature development, so first you need to create from this development branch a feature development branch. So at that situation, you can create, you can select the branch name here, and you can create that branch from here. From command line, what, how you will do, you will first check out to the development branch, and then you create a branch from there with your corresponding branch name, so that it will be from dev, that branch will be created. And once this is done, it will merge to your dev branch, and everything goes fine, all the testing validation, then it will merge to your master branch. So this is a bit highlight of branching strategy. So if time permits, we'll cover branching strategy as well in some of the sessions. So it will be more clear how industry is following branching strategy. So here I'm just creating from the master branch, create a branch. So here you see I have created test branching. So this is the branch currently I'm in. So after this creation, we'll get this kind of you push the test branching just now. Okay. So now comes how to add a file from GUI. So from the GitLab interface. So for adding the file, we have already covered in through command line how you are going to add it. So simply create a file and add some content, and then you need to add that file into your staging area. Then you need to commit it, and then you need to push it to your remote repository. Then it will be visible in your in the remote repository. Okay. So similarly, from GitLab interface, you can use the add a file. So here I have first mentioned how to in command line, you can just simply write the execute the command like touch and some file name. So it will directly create in your working directory the file. And then the subsequent process, commit it, edit, commit it, and push it. So from GitLab interface, you can simply go to the GUI part, and here you can see a one plus sign where the drop down will be opened, and there you can create a new file. It's like something. Here you see we are in this branch, and now if you click on this drop down, you will get a new file. Okay, so you can give the file name here. You can also select a template if you want to use something, git ignore. So this is just for your reference, like if I want this file to be ignored when I commit it, so you can choose git ignore. If you want some Docker file to be created, you can simply write this YML file, some license file. So you can, there are some pre-configured templates available. So here also we have options like will it be a simply text or it is base 64. So sometimes you need to convert your in case of like tokens. If you are using some JWT token for your API interface to be communicated, so there from automation point of view, or from some functionality like if you are creating some batch job something, so there you need to decode that token into base64 something. So you can use this option as well here. So here I can simply write whatever the file I'm creating, like if you want to snippet your code as well directly, like some Python code, Java code, so you can directly copy here and you can directly push that code into this branch. So here I'm just writing some text. This is for branching test. This is to test branching. Okay, and you go below, will get commit changes. So this is the commit message. Whatever we are doing from the command line tool, we are creating a file, then we are adding that. And after adding it in the staging area, we are committing like a short message, like what is this commit is for. This is the same thing, commit message. And what is your target branch? Here it is. From this branch, I have created the file, so it is automatically saying which is the target branch where this file will be committed. So I can change this commit message. New file for branching test. Now I'm doing commit changes. So you see, this branch has this file now, and this is the commit message. Since this is one liner, so it is visible. If it is of your 100 lines of code, so please just snippet a small amount of code that yes, it is done. So I think you got a commit ID as well here. Okay. So this is all happens in your remote repository. So if you want this to be visible, you need to take a git pull and check out this branch. You will get these changes. We can try that as well. This one, right? Okay. Yes. I'm in some branch, I guess. So.
You can it? Yeah, I was just about to say increase the font. Thanks.
Yeah, I increase actually. So now I can see if okay, I guess we have not pushed it, right? We need to give the, we need to do the merge request, then only it will be shown in the master, because this all happens in the remote, so local is not aware of this. So this we covered. Now we'll see rebase operation. So in the git session, we just discuss what is rebase operation. So we can easily do rebase operation from GitLab vpart. So what is rebase? It is simply your way of merging master to your branch when you are working with long running branches, long running branch. Like if you are working in a big feature, like it is taking so much of time and we are working since long in a particular branch, and the master head is master timeline is going forward from your from when you created the branch. So in that situation, you can time to time merge your the master code into your branch, and you can get the updated code. so that while you are merging your changes to the master, you will not get overhead of, like, there are a lot of commits left behind, and now I'm taking so much time to take those latest code into my branch. So to avoid that, we can use redress functionality. So these are the steps how you can do redress of your code. So go to your project directory, create new branch. We have already created a branch. Okay. So let's try this. So we are already.
We can do this with a git merge as well, right? Merging the master with the feature branch or whatever the branch name. Right, then what
yes,
is
yes,
the...
Yes. You can do it through command line.
Any other feature of this command rebase? Why rebase exists? Because we have merged, right?
No, what I'm saying. So here is your master branch, and from here you have created a branch, okay? Suppose B1 is your branch, and this is your long development is ongoing. So here you get multiple other people are also working in this branch, and you got latest changes. So, but these changes are not in your branch because you have already created a branch much before these changes. So now while you are going to merge this in your master branch or dev branch, so these changes are not in your local branch, right? So to take these changes into your branch, so the rebase operation is required.
I understood that part.
So
that's what I'm
saying. Yeah, Ravindra, you can do the merge also. So I got a point. So you can do the merge also. It's not a issue. Like, you know, both
yeah,
the
yeah,
things,
you can
do the same thing. But rebase, what happens, like, if you do a merge, then you will have three commits in your picture branch or branch in which you are working. Correct, but rebase, like, you know, these all will be consolidated, so you will not see three check-ins or commits into your local branch. So basically, both are same, similar thing. Basically, does the final goal is same thing? How it does and what are its impacts? They are little bit different.
Yeah, both the operations. In fact, I guess rebase is doing the same thing.
But generally, it is
merging only.
Correct. So, but it is recommended to do the rebase because you don't have to take all the commits. Otherwise, like, you know, if there are 15 commits, then all those 15 commits would be shown on your local branch, and finding a difference would become different. With the rebase, you will only have a one commit created in your branch, and there you can see like what all things came from your target branch. So that makes things easier with respect to debugging the things or maybe reviewing what changes you have done.
Okay.
So I hope that helps in
yes.
Okay, so this is a snippet of the complete list of commands which I have mentioned in this. So how we did it, like, and this is from command line we did it. So we created a branch and then went to that branch and added some file into that branch and then committed that changes to that branch. Okay, so we'll get now your this branch is now having your latest changes. So during the same time, we checked into the master and created the updated the readme.md file with some more commands. So it means we have forwarded that master head to a one more commit. Okay, so now this rebase example branch is created in a previous commit from the master, and now master is bit forward with a one commit. So I want to merge that commit into my local branch. So you can just execute this command git rebase master, so that it will pick the latest commit of master into your local branch. Okay, then you can see the readme.md file. So I think the rebase this command git rebase master is might be in the background doing the same thing, merge kind of activity. So maybe we can explore more what is inside happening when we execute this rebase master. So we can try as well that. So we have which branch we have available. We have created one more branch, right? Testing branch, we can do yes. Okay. So we have second file, readme, what is in the readme.md. Okay. I'm going to just edit some command in this branch. So git status. Okay, second file is also we did some changes in that file. Okay, this is not yet committed. So git add dot. We have added both the files. Okay, then git commit and then okay. So now I am not pushing my code. Okay. So we reached till here. We did some commit in my local branch. Now go to master. Okay. And here I am going to edit readme file.
Font size is very small. You can increase it.
Now it's visible.
Yes, now it is better. Yes.
Okay. So I have simply modified the readme.md file, and now I'm adding this. Okay. So this is my latest changes now. Now you can see git checkout DBS operation. Done any changes? What is saying modified? Or might be some space has been added here. So now we can git this is a command I guess, right? Okay. Get add. Now if I see, now you can see I got the new changes from master to here. So git log. Okay, so this is the history of my branch. If I so I have it's clear, right? What we did in the rebase. So we have first created a branch, then we add some changes some file in my branch, and then we check out to the master, and we did modified the readme.md file, added some lines. So that same line, the same changes from readme.md I want in my local branch. So for that we did rebase operation. So next is squashing commits. Just give me a second. So squashing functionality is like it's a way of combining all your commits into one when you are obtaining a merge request. Like if you have, we have like 10 or 15 commits you have did, but you want those to be gone in a single commit. So this operation helps in that. So what are the steps to do it? We go to the your branch which we have created, and one more add one more commit into that. This is a example. You can add this line or whatever you want that commit message, then commit it. Now squash the above two commits. We have already done one commit here, and if we add one more commit into that, and but during the squash operation, during the final merging, we want these two commits to be a single commit, then squash operation will help you. So the command will be git rebase -i head 2. 2 is like how many commits you want to squashing. If you have 4 commits, if you have 5 commits, you can just simply mention the number here. So it will simply squash those 2 changes. So after executing this command, redis-i head 2, you will get a window like this. It will show all the commit messages. So you need to provide which commits you want to squash. So this pick message, like the second line in the right hand side of first snapshot, the second line is the latest commit, and you want to squash these changes to the first one. So you just simply edit the pick line with squash and you save it. Now after that, you need to push the branch to the remote repository, so it will show the single commit. Okay, we can try that as well. So here we have, there is no change in this, so we can create one more, like files first, second file, what is in the second file. You can add here squash creation. Okay, so then it commit. Okay, so now we have 2 commits. Previously we did one change in the test one file, I think, first one file, and then we did changes in the second file. Okay, so now we have 2 commits now available. Let's see git log. we have rebase operation, modified MD. We have 3. I guess okay, here we have added one space, that's why we did this. So we have, I guess, 3 commits. So for that, git rebase-i add 3. So here we got 3 commits. Where is the cursor? So I can simply write squl splash I need to check the spell if this is the okay. And now you can save it. This is a combination of 3 commits. This is first commit. So it will show you the detail of the commits which you have, the changes. Okay. Okay. So now you can see 3 files changed, 6 insertions successfully rebased and updated these. So sig log. Now you can see these 3 are now combined, these 3 with a single commit. Okay. So now we can push the branch to git push origin. Sorry. Rebase operation. Now we can go to our this and see three branches. So this is the rebase branch, we got it. Okay, we have pushed it, but it is not yet merged. So we will get a merge request from here. Okay, so we'll discuss next how to do the merge request. Let me see the changes. So these are the changes we did, and now we get a single commit of these all these three changes. Okay, these are the commits. And if you see the single commit for all these. Okay. So what is merge request? The next feature, it is simply review our code with your colleagues and your teammates, so that if there is something wrong in your logic or some implementation fault, or there is some syntax problem, so you can give the comments into that. And after the approval of the required person, you can simply merge that into your master branch. Then only your features will be visible and available to your to everybody. So through command line, we simply execute the command like git merge and this merge request. So it will be merged into your local repository. Okay, but when you push that code into your remote repository, there has to be some mechanism that there should be some check that after the review of this code, that only go into your the main branch. So this feature helps with this. So Git doesn't support it, so that's why we need to choose either GitLab or Bitbucket to do this. What are the steps for this merge request? So before creating any merge request, guys, one more thing I left here. So for squashing commit, there should be at least two minimum commits, because it itself was defines, right? If you have multiple commits, then only you are going to have this squash operation. If you have single commit, then it is not the case. So before creating new merging request, there should be a created branch in your GitLab. Obviously, because if you want to do the merge request, so for which branch you are going to do this merge request and for which code base. Okay. So these are the steps. So we can directly go to that, and here I guess we can do the merge request operation. So we'll get this this many options to provide before submitting the merge request. So another way of doing merge request is like we can grow from here also. If you see the left panel, here it's a merge request, and you can do the create merge request. Okay, so let me see, there will be some option like which branch you need to choose. Create merge request.
So Vibhu, what happens, like, you know, yeah, as soon as you
mm-hmm.
But once you get this new email notification, so if you create a new merge request, it will be created using that branch itself. So like now here
yeah,
you
see I'm just
from
searching,
DBase operation.
I'm just searching. We have multiple branches we have created right from this. So I'm just searching repository branches.
Here also you have a merge request, like if you want to create a merge
yeah.
request for a particular branch.
Yes, yes. Okay, I am already in this branch, that's why it is showing that panel itself. These are the options. But there, I guess there is some option also from where you can choose that what is the source branch and the destination branch.
Okay. That you will see when you will be merging it.
Okay.
So basically, as of now,
so here,
yeah, you are just. As of now, you are just choosing the branch and you know, inviting other people to give their code review comments. So once code is okay, everybody is okay with their comments or their comments have been incorporated or disposed of, then you choose where to merge this branch into. So your target branch could be different from your source branch also.
Might be from here what it's doing. It is the same. Okay. Yeah, Anil, you are correct. So here it's a nice summary. We can give what is this merge request for. We can give the feature name or whatever the work you have done. Might be you have split the feature into multiple tasks and you are picking one of the tasks. You can give this title. So I would recommend that you should give a meaningful name here so that the reviewer is quite comfortable by seeing these messages, so that it can help him or her to do the review process. And here you can write the description, whatever. So it is by default taking the commit messages while doing the commit. We provided these messages, so it is by default taking this. You can edit also here. What is this discussion for? You can attach file for if you have done some kind of validation, if you've done some unit testing in your local system, or if some code logic has been implemented based on some email criteria that there is some discussion done with your client and or your stakeholders, and we have concluded some decision we did these changes due to this is the artifact of that. You can attach the file here also. You can assign, since here we have done a private project, so the user is only me. But in an organization, you should have a group of people to whom you are going to assign this for this merge request, so that he or she can approve it. Milestone. You can create we discussed the tagging concepts that can also help here, or if you have created any milestone production 1.0 or production 1.1 kind of milestone, you can add that milestone so that it will be easy to track that for this milestone how many merge requests or how many commits we have done so far. This is level. You can add your own level, there is some fixes related to security, or there is some fixes related to your code base, some new API implementation has been done, so you can mention it here, or you can add the level feature name, licensing, or you can say that login functionality. You can add those levels here also. If you have any external dependency for this merge request, if it is calling to some third party link or something, you can mention here the dependencies. Here there is a option like approval rules. So any eligible user, if you want this, that I should need two minimum approvals to merge this request into master. So unless two person provide the approval, you cannot merge that. So generally minimum two approval is being followed in most of the industries. And you can also add customized approval rule, that what is the rule name you can give, number of approvals. You can mention the approver's email ID, or you can add the user also here, so that person only when approves, that will allow to merge into the master. Otherwise, it will be disabled. Okay, so these are for security purposes, so that nobody can add its means nobody can add his or her code changes to directly to the master or the developer branch without any approval, without any review. So that is protecting your branching concept. Okay, so here we can you can assign to me, let's see, I'm giving one approval. Okay, and here it is showing that delete source branch when merge request is accepted. So this is for cleanup activity, and this is squash commits when merge request is accepted. Like multiple commits can be squashed in a single commit. So I'm not doing anything squashing here. I'm just giving this submit merge request. Okay. So here also now we are getting options. You can add it here itself if you want to. So here you can see this is, I guess, the approval. So there are two thumbs, then you will be able to approve it. Otherwise, it won't merge. So it's not yet merge, I guess. I'm giving, see, this is the merge option is now disabled because I have given at least one person should give the approval. So if I give this one, I need to go to that. Changes. These are the changes. This is the commit. Where is that approval? Previous merge commits. Require approval. I think there is some change in this UI. Anil, do you see where the approval button
just is? Just go to this view approval, just go a little down. So you assigned it to yourself, correct? You assigned it to yourself.
Yes, but I need to approve it, right? Where is that approval button?
Just go to the merge request again. Top level. From left side. No.
Open 2 minutes ago. One left. Record approval it is saying, but oh,
Generally, you get this group button if you are a human.
Yes, I am also wondering where that button gone. Enable in.
Okay, so you can show how to give comments also.
Yeah.
How the comments are disposed.
यहाँ पे कुछ आता है मर्ज रिक्वेस्ट के वन ओपन
But if you are approver, then you get this green big button.
I have not tried, like myself is approver, I just give it a try. But I am wondering where is that button. Okay. You can go to the comments.
Just go to the changes and do some
here you can add the comment, right? Here you can
add comment and then dispose.
Say more code, something like this, okay? And start a review. So here we have given one comment that this line has to be changed something. So this is just an example, okay? If you didn't the real code, so you can add these comments like this. So unless this comment has been incorporated and you will get another commit for that, or you get a satisfactory answer for that, then we'll give after that only we'll give a approval. So
okay, you do the finish review. What is the difference is, like, you know, GitLab basically comes into two versions. One is the enterprise edition, which is this one, and one is the community edition, which basically we normally install for our in-premise Git part. So mostly most of the organizations, they do the community part, or they have their own internal in-house deployment of GitLab. So that's why the difference is, so in community edition you have that button which comes up, correct, and you also have only one approval functionality there. But since this is a community edition, so here you have a functionality where you can choose multiple people also. So that's why you are seeing this difference. So you just do the up this one, upvote, and this upvote functionality is also there in the community edition. So obviously, like, you know, community and enterprise will have certain differences, right? And so now you see you have you vote up once again.
Yeah, this is the only thing. If I click again, it is going zero.
So vote up is like you are okay with your.
But how? Why it is showing this merge request? You can only merge once this merge request is approved. Yes, but where to approve it?
So you who was the approver? You yourself, you just try to change that approver once again. Edit this merge request. Achha, for the time being, what you can do, you can remove that check for approvals. You can let us see.
Might be where to edit it.
On the top.
No, here, this next to the closed merge request. No, you just click it. Here you have a assignment. So, okay, open this.
This one, right?
Any, no, not here. Just go to the merge request.
For this branch, for this project, we have created this second file.
We just go to this merge request. You can go from left side also. Just left merge request. Okay. Then you have this edit merge request on the top also.
Okay.
Choose your merge request. No, choose your one for DBS operation. So on the center menu, you have this DBS operations.
Where you are saying?
This one in the just put on. Here you have a checkbox for DBS operations. Just come down, not here, in the center panel. In the central panel, you have this up, board, down,
boarding. Just a second. This one, right? For DBS operation.
Now,
then here, select status, assign.
Just go down, unassign. Update on. And now see. Because most of the organizations for security purpose, na, they don't use this GitLab, publicly hosted GitLab. So,
still I'm getting merges.
Okay. No issues. We can do it later on also. So, once everything is okay,
if I do,
then this
screen button. If I do here, close merge request, what will happen?
Close, matlab, basically what happens in merge request? Merge request can be verified, okay, and that can be in good shape to merge it. So that is a one way. So you merge that merge request, and sometimes you do some changes and you know get it reviewed also. But at the end, you say it's like, no, I don't want to merge it to the main branch. So just for example, demo branches or like some those kinds of things. So you close those merge requests. So once you close those merge requests, they will not be merged to any target branch. So that is only for intermediate users. So that is the overall life cycle of merge request.
Okay.
So no issues.
Close now. We can reopen the merge request again. Okay. Yeah,
you can reopen it. Yeah, but reopen normally what happens, like you know, once a merge request is closed or it is merged, then reopening, especially if it is merged, then even if you reopen it, so you won't be able to re-merge it. So basically, these two stages are the end stages for merge request. So if you want to do similar changes, then you should create a new feature branch and create a new merge request. So you can reopen it, but you won't be able to merge anything to the target branch.
Okay.
So normally what happens, like, you know, this merge request part, if it is done by the developers, right? But from the DevOps perspective, what is important is how to enable this merge, like, you know, so if you see the overall structure, once somebody does a code check-in, then we should have a complete CI pipeline running, and only then merge request should be allowed. So if you see from that perspective, if some developer does a check-in,
he raises a merge request, that should trigger our CI pipeline, correct? So code should be checked out, and you know, unit testing should be done. If static analysis is done, is needed, that should be done. And then that trigger should come to the GitLab, like, you know, now it is ready for merge. And only then reviewer should be like, you know, should do the code review and press the merge request if he is happy with the code review comments. So this is why we are discussing, like, you know, there would be a placeholder. So even if you see here, so if you see there is a in this diagram, you have a green checkbox and then a red cross. So red cross is basically for a pipeline. So GitLab also provides their own CI/CD functionality similar to Jenkins. So you can also create your CI pipeline using GitLab, but that is more what you can say bound to a particular platform. So normally people, they integrate Jenkins pipeline. So once like that is integrated, then pipeline succeeds, only then this merge button is enabled. Otherwise, developer has to fix it and we commit the changes. So this is the overall, like, you know, use case for this merge request with respect to DevOps perspective. DevOps. So we should be able to create a trigger so that your pipeline is triggered, and once your pipeline is completed, you should be able to send response back to the GitLab so that GitLab starts or enables or disables this merge based upon pipeline status. So we will cover this integration in coming sessions also, but from that perspective, what is a merge request, how it happens, what are, how the code reviews are done, correct, and how what are the signings, these kind of a things, they are important. So that's why we are discussing in today's session. Okay, now you can start.
Resolved. Yeah, I'm just okay, checking why it is still, I don't know.
We can check it, yeah, because I am not sure, I have not much worked on Enterprise Edition, so we can explore okay. It and come back next.
Okay, we'll see why it is not happening. So simply this snippet, if you see, I did previously also, that it was coming as after merge this, so you will get this one, and after this it will show you the merge is successful. So this is simply the okay, let me any questions guys so far?
Because merge request will be important with respect to the like, you know, integrating the CI and CD path. So CI will be triggered based upon merge request. So most of the organizations, they use merge request. Even some people who are using GitHub, they call it pull request. So basically concept is same. But it is, some people they call it pull request, or somewhere it is called as merge request. But still, both things are the triggers for your CI pipeline.